I want to begin by saying, well, first of all, you all came back. How wonderful. But I'm impressed by saying something that I said in passing, and I want to be sure that it gets more than just in passing. People who are 40 or 45 and under were born with emergent sensibilities, and they're not going to be able to change it. Okay? The things that we talk about as emergent sensibilities are there. Any more than they change the color of their eyes. You were born in a different context, different sociological, cultural, temporal. Everything is different. One of the more interesting things, and it does affect your work as clergy, is that people 60 or 65 and over are increasingly persuaded by much of what's going on in emergence. That is to say, when I go in to an emergence meeting or gathering, they call them cohorts. What we call parishes, they call cohorts. Don't know why. Makes no sense. Roman military unit, but whatever. When I used to go in, it was all fairly young people, maybe a tenth were older. Now when I go in, I'd say somewhere between a quarter and a third of the people gathered there are as white-haired as I am, which is to say that, I think it's to say, that somewhere over about 60 to 65, we get a certain impunity. We have time. We're not threatened in any way. I mean, I'm 78. I'll be 79 in a couple of months. I should hurt my career. I mean, what are you going to do to me? Come on, let's get real. And have a certain amount of money and time to do it with. I think there's another factor, too, and I want to address it this afternoon. I think that my favorite Carol Burnett joke of all was when she said kids and their grandparents get along so well because they have a common enemy. And I think she's right. I think she's right. And there is a push in almost every established congregation where I go on the part of the grandparent level to try to figure out what this is and to connect with it. I was in an all-day meeting about 3 weeks ago, as a matter of fact, and the 2 o'clock session started, and this woman didn't come in, and when she did come in, she was like this about 20 minutes late, and afterwards she said, "I am so sorry. I was Skyping my 9-year-old granddaughter, and I couldn't get her off the phone. I couldn't get her off the computer." And I thought, at 2 o'clock, she's got a 9-year-old she's Skyping with, and immediately the mother in me, you know, kicked in, and I said, "Does your son know she's doing that?" "My son doesn't know about Skyping. He can't do it." You know, like, what hole did you crawl out under? You know? And I thought, there it is. So all of which is to say, from a pastor's point of view, from a rector's point of view, from a church person's point of view, we need to remember that the growth areas in emergence Christianity are the 40 and 45 and under, and the 60 and 65 over, in terms of their interest, in terms of people being attracted to the institution. Emergence is by and large missional. It is the nature of the institution to be attractional. It has to be. It has to, in order to have a tomorrow, it's got to have more and more numbers and more people and more money, right? Those parishes are growing all over North America and in the UK. Those parishes are growing, which play to or are concerned with for that mid-demographic, from 40 or 45 over to 60 or 65. That age bracket, because we marry later now, we bear children later, and as a result, we hit pubescence, if you will, at the same time that we hit the middle age crisis. And neither of them should have an accompaniment. Both of them are disastrous. Together, they're just agony. And Diana Butler Bass is the authority on this. She's got enough footnotes to make anybody happy. The parishes that are growing are those that understand that people in that age group, all over the anglicized world, are those who want to be more Presbyterian than John Calvin ever was, or more Anglican than Hooker ever was. They need the rules, please, because everything's going to hell in a handbasket at home. And, you know, would you please use the institution to tell this kid to sit down, shut up, and listen to me while I have a crisis, kind of thing. And it's true. It's a demographic. And so I wanted to make it clear, though I had sort of passed at it, that there is an operative demographic here. And also that those who are 40 and under, or 45 and under, are going to be emergents. They can't help it. And so we might just as well deal with it. And the next thing I want to say is that I realized in the bathroom I hadn't said it. I have some of my greatest inspirations in there, as a matter of fact. So do you, I suspect. But we need to be really clear that Protestantism isn't dying. Anglicanism isn't dying. It's just not going to happen. Roman Catholicism didn't die 500 years ago. Orthodoxy didn't die 1,000 years ago. Patristic Christianity didn't die 1,500 years ago. It just didn't. Every time we go through one of these things, whatever holds pride of place, whatever holds hegemony, has to drop back and reconfigure and change, but it never ceases to be. Anglicanism isn't going to die at all. The truth of it is, 500 years ago, if Roman Catholics had been as absorbed with figures as you and I are and our colleagues are right now, they would have been in total panic because Roman Catholicism was going to... because there was nothing to make Protestants out of except Roman Catholics. So, of course, their numbers... I mean, you know, let's get honest, you know. It's true. And there's nothing to make emergence out of except you and me. I mean, that's it. And so we're going to have to reconfigure. And that's exactly what's going on. And you can look at France in February. Established the United Reformed Church of France, for goodness sakes, in which all of the major Reformed faiths said, okay, we can't run separate offices. We're coming together and making one thing. The World Council, the National Council of Churches, the World Council of Churches, many of those are expressions of reconfiguration. But there's no need to despair. And for what it's worth, the Church of England has been in every way, I would say, the international leader as Jerusalem in trying to reach out to Antioch. Primarily because of Rowan Williams. What Archbishop Justin Welby is going to do is another issue. I can't tell. But Rowan Williams has been very sure that this is indeed a new thing God is doing and to try to support it. And so he has in every way made clergy available to groups of six and seven. He has opened up public space. He's seen that there was money when it was needed in every way. And that was because he believed that this is indeed a new thing God is doing. There's no question in his mind about that. The thing about it is that the Church of England has not grown since Henry VIII was buried, right? I mean, you know, you're born into it, you die into it, the birth rate doesn't change very much, the figures don't change very much, until 3 years ago. And 3 years ago, the Church of England had a little burp. It was less than 1 point percentage growth. And everybody said, it must be a mathematical error. Last year, it grew again, almost a full percentage point. That's not why you do this. That's not why you engage emergence Christianity, but it is an interesting byproduct of it, which is to say that established or natal or traditional church, whatever you want to call it, picked up membership as a result of its intentional nurture of emergence Christianity. You can see the same thing 500 years ago when Roman Catholicism began to grow a little bit. After the Counter-Reformation had died down, it began to pick up some people too. People who had some Protestant leanings but who wanted to stay with natal church. So it's there's no reason to hang crape about this. Also, because one of you said something, I overheard you say something. Yes, you're absolutely right. I'm doing a sociological cascade, if I ever get around to it in a minute. I'm doing a sociological cascade. Yes, you can do a political one. Yes, you can do an economic one with Marx. Yes, yeah. But you can, and to answer your comment, you can also do a religious one. That is to say, if you will look at the 19th century, you will see, especially on this continent, the restlessness of people trying to form a new church before they got to the idea of emergence church or emergence Christianity. You can see the restlessness, and it presents as Mormonism. It presents as Christian Science. It presents as the establishment of Jehovah's Witnesses. It presents as the establishment of Seventh-day Adventism. It presents as New Thought Church. It presents as Foursquare Gospel. You can, the whole 19th century, this whole area of peri-emergence is rife with attempts to refashion Christianity. So what we're doing is not without precedent, okay? It took all of that, all of those things that didn't satisfy the itch, though they have continued. Didn't solve the thing. So it was a while before we got to emergence. So yes, you can indeed do, if you wish to use the term, you can do ecclesially. you can do a cascade. You can also do one theologically to answer that other question, which is to say, those of you who are watching here are aware that by 1869, we're convening Vatican I, right? Why are we convening Vatican I? Vatican I only does one thing in its whole life, right? One thing. It sits for 92 years or something like that, and there's only one thing. And what is that thing? That when the Pope speaks from the chair of Peter, he speaks infallibly. Ex cathedra. Papal, you know. Why? Rome's been here before, bought that t-shirt, and didn't like the way it fit. And so they're blocking the door. The minute Faraday and company begin to make these noises, Rome's on it. Nope. We're going to block that door. So we get papal inerrancy to replace biblical inerrancy. It's clear. By 1865 and 70, you're getting the Niagara Committee of Biblical Inerrancy. They finally end up as the Committee of Biblical Conservatives. And by 1895, they are putting out this edict. They're meeting in Niagara Falls. You guys and us guys were all playing together. Niagara Falls is where we meet, right, to make mayhem. North Americans all met together, and they formed this committee. And they came up with the five things you had to believe to be Christian. We've always had creeds, you know, but this isn't a creed. This is a code of armor, of honor. You've got to sign off on this thing, or you are not Christian by our definition. And the first thing is you have to believe that the scriptures are inspired by the Holy Spirit. The second thing you have to believe in is the historicity of the virgin birth. The third thing, at some point, wouldn't you think Jesus Christ as the Son of God would have been number one, or at least number two, or number three? It never gets there. What they're defending is doctrine. What they're defending, the last one is the nature of the atonement. And by 1910, they're publishing a magazine called The Fundamentals. And we're going to get the word the fundamentalist out of them, right? So there's a whole reaction going on through all of this, and we don't need to avoid it. But yes, we're absolutely right in what I overheard. You can do it ecclesially. You can also do it theologically. I just want to do it sociologically because I think that's the hot button right now. And if you will, and then I'm going to do a decade. But if you'll go with me on the sociological cascade, with full knowledge that there are other cascades happening. In the years between 1855 and 1859, and while the Civil War happened in my country, it involved Canada and the UK. The battles that were being fought were fought amongst English poor, English-speaking culture. There's no question about it. My grandfather, we do refer to it as the recent great unpleasantness in the South. My grandfather was actually shot at Shiloh. And every Southerner you ever knew had a grandfather who was shot at Shiloh. Mine really was. It's a kind of, mark of honor. But my father was the 15th of his 16 children, so clearly nothing important got hit. But nonetheless, yes, ma'am. When you got 16 of the little boogers, you got something going for you. Took two women to do it, but that's okay. Not simultaneously, in seriatim, okay? Nonetheless, in the years preparatory to Fort Sumter, to the firing by Yankee forces on Southern forces at Fort Sumter, there is an accumulated volume of correspondence between Northern churchmen and Southern churchmen that's fascinating. Perhaps the Presbyterian Communion in my country has the best archive, or at least it's the one I have seen most completely, in which the Northern churchmen and the Southern churchmen are trying to avoid war. In every way. And the Southern churchmen, nearer and nearer as you get to 59 and the outbreak in 60 of the war itself, the Southern churchmen are saying, can we just get rid of slavery without calling it wrong? Now, there's a reason for that. Of course, it doesn't take a genius to see what their problem is. The Bible does not say, thou shalt go forth and buy a human being. It doesn't. But the Bible clearly admits of slavery, does it not? Leviticus and Deuteronomy have provision for owning people. I mean, and you can say, okay, that's an ancient time, and try to get rid of it. If you're a good Protestant inerrancist, you can't. But, if you're sort of a sloppy one, you can say, okay, that's ancient history. But you get to our Lord, and he tells two or three stories about people with slaves and about slaves. And you can say, okay, so that's a narrative sort of contrivance or construction. And then you hit Paul. Have you ever noticed we always hit Paul? It bothers me. If I ever get to the same place he is, we're going to have words, St. Paul and I. He said things only a bachelor could say and go home at night. But anyway, it's true. It's true. But you hit Onesimus and Philemon, right? There is no question that the Bible admits of slavery without a by your leave. It's a fool who says it doesn't. And so the Southern churchmen, because they were and traditionally have been a bit more Protestant than any other part of the English-speaking world, we're dying over this. Just don't call it wrong. We'll disestablish it, but don't call it wrong. It's the first major chip, sociologically speaking, it's the first major chip against biblical inerrancy or Protestant inerrancy, if you will. It is followed very shortly by those uppity women. In my part of the world, we give college degrees to women in being uppity because it's seen as a real virtue. I'm not a feminist, and I need to preface my remarks here by saying I'm not a feminist. I discovered years ago that you can't have 7 children by the same man and be credible as a feminist. It just won't play in Poughkeepsie. It won't. I got called down a few times, and I just thought, forget it. I will just admit, I'm not a feminist. I am too old to be a feminist, probably. And from my point of view, and it's my one feminist joke, I don't understand why my younger sisters wanted to give up being superior just to be equal. That I'll never understand. But, and I'm dead serious. I am dead serious. But you get, you'd always had the uppity women, but by the time you get to the First World War and the years after, you get women who say, I will own property. I will own property without a male co-signator. I will have a bank account. I will have one without a male co-signator. I will have these things for myself. And there is in Greek literature a great play called the Lysistrata by Aristophanes. And the Lysistrata has a very appropriate thesis here. The thesis is that if enough women get together and promise each other that at all costs they're going to have what they've agreed upon and what they want, they will get it because they can cut off the supply. And it's not supper we're talking about. And it absolutely worked. You can look. You can look in that your country, my country. These are the years in which we began to empower women economically. Now, is the Bible gender equal? I don't care how many translations you put out or how many you sell on Amazon. The Bible is patriarchal, right? It's an absolute fact. It's patriarchal. It's a fool who argues it's not. But nonetheless, what we've got now is the next blow, if you will, the next blow against that inerrancy, against that thing. Because now we're empowering women. Why are we empowering women? Because we want what it is they've got, even as they want what we've got. And so we come to a kind of gentleman's agreement, if you will, and we empower them. And we're going to continue to empower them, and we're going to take it right up to, let's go to 1941 to 45. 1941, December the 7th. I remember it so well. We were on our way to church. It was a Sunday night. I was 7 years old and had a new pair of saddle Oxfords, and the newsboys started yelling, "Extra, extra, Pearl Harbor bombed!" And my father bought a newspaper and turned around and went straight back home, and I cried all the way over my new shoes that I was going to brag about. And he kept telling me to hush, that I didn't understand the significance of it. So I remember Pearl Harbor very well. We had taken, in the States, we had taken all of the all the munitions, if you will, the materials of war, left over from the First World War and shipped them to Japan because we were too lazy, if you will, to disestablish them and recycle them. And Japan recycled them and sent them back. We called it Pearl Harbor. When that happened, there was absolutely, you guys were in better shape than we. There was absolutely nothing to fight back with. We had nothing. I don't think many people realize how little there was. There were no arsenals. There was nothing. All we had was men. Johnny, we called him. Johnny, who was going to go off to war and whom we drafted immediately and gave him nothing to fight with. And all we had besides Johnny was Rosie. Originally, she was Wendy the welder, and then she became Rosie the riveter for us. And she's an icon in your country as well as in mine. I saw her the other day, whole bank of her, as a matter of fact, in the airport. She was all that we had. And Rosie went to work. Rosie did what she had to do in order to get Johnny back. She took the 2.5 kids down the sidewalk, down the picket fence to Grandma's house and left them. Grandma hated this war more than anybody else, but nonetheless, you know, she did. And for the first time, Rosie, for the first time, a reasonably privileged female in Western culture is going to work outside of the home. Now, if she had been serf or slave, she would have been doing somebody's laundry or been maid to somebody. But we're talking about an established woman who has, you know, a home, who's not destitute, going to work for the sake of the home. Now, let the record show, she's not going to make a career. She's going out there because it's the only way she's going to get Johnny back. And so that's what she's doing. But what happens, first of all, she earns money. Well, you know, we paid in my country $24 a month to our corporals, for heaven's sakes. You couldn't feed anybody on $24 a month. She had to work financially. But she's got money. Secondly, she's got money that doesn't have anybody else arbitrating for her what she's doing with it. The University of Michigan has perhaps the best women's studies file I've ever seen. And it's full of stuff. Some of it would break your heart. And two or three of the things in there do break my heart every time I look at them. Which is to say, there are letters there, and they go something like this. Dear Mama, and you know, this is Rosie writing home. Dear Mama, it took me 6 weeks, but I saved up enough money to get the lipstick. And you should see it, Mama. It's beautiful. I can hardly wait to go to church. But Johnny would never have let me buy it. Or the ones that moved me up. Dear Mama, he got it. He got the wagon. And you should have seen his face, Mama, when he opened it. It took me 6 months, but I got it for him. And he's so happy. And Johnny would never have let me spend the money that way. You see, what she's doing is she's beginning. Followed by the fact that within 6 months of Rosie going to work, Rosie discovers she has some opinions. Rosie discovers also that she's very tired at the end of 10 hours. The University of Michigan is very clear about this. That she's very tired at the end of 10 hours of working. And then she remembers that Johnny sometimes was too tired. You know where this is going. Johnny was too tired to come home, and so he would stop at the pub and he'd get one or two. And we were all really glad because he was a lot nicer when he came home that way, you know. And she thinks, maybe I'll stop at the pub. So she calls Grandma and says, you know, will you keep the kids a little longer? I'm going to stop with the girls. Now, is Rosie becoming a drunk? No. Do you all have the Watkins man? Do you know what the Watkins man is? The spice man that delivers by the house? Well, he's a big brown truck and he delivers spices and extracts and all of that. And we used to have a joke that only the Watkins man understands and knows, which is to say that any household that needed 3 quarts of almond extract a week had a problem. If there's not any question that Rosie, if she wanted to be a drunk, could have been a drunk and was a drunk already and had ways to get. What matters is, and the scholar here is Ray Olenberg, and he's got a fascinating study on it. What matters is that Rosie, for the first time, has found a non-domestic, non-ecclesial space in which she can talk about non-domestic issues. She's found what's called the third good place. Now, all of a sudden, she can say to a bunch of women with whom she's working, that part of the line is wrong. We ought to fix it. Or the boss is a jerk. I don't like him. Or she can talk about something besides quilting and laundry and cooking and child rearing. She's playing with a world outside the home. And she's never going to forget that experience. Okay? There's nothing wrong with it. It just happens. Now, she does her job well, and Johnny comes home again. We call him June and Ward Cleaver because she goes back to being Mrs. Johnny, doesn't she? Of course she does. Absolutely she does. She's delighted to have him home, and it's just fine, except June and Ward Cleaver of the TV series only had 2 little boys. They should have had a little girl or two. If they'd had a little girl or two, we'd have called them Gloria Steinem or Betty Friedan. Those names mean anything to you? Yes. Uh-huh. Absolutely. Absolutely. And those are the girl children who were reared, who left childhood and entered adolescence in the years when Johnny was gone. And they are the girls who said, oh, things were different after Daddy came home. before Daddy came home, and this really is not a dumping on guys, believe it or not, it's not. I never saw a guy I didn't think was not worth looking at least twice. So please, you know, please don't misunderstand. It's just a sociological fact. These are the girls who said, you know, when Daddy was not here, I could ask Mama for something, and I either got it or didn't get it, according to how much we had, and I believed her. Now I have to go ask Daddy, and I'm not quite sure whether I believe what he's saying or not, but I'm pretty sure when she says, go ask your father, I'm not going to get it. When Daddy wasn't here, Mama hummed a lot, and Mama even whistled, and there are records of this. And now Daddy is home, and he says, you know, whistling women are like crowing hens. They come to no good ends. And so Mama doesn't do that anymore. More to the point, and the records are clear here, these are the girls who said, when Daddy wasn't here, I didn't hear those ugly noises. I didn't hear those raised voices after lights out. And I'm not going to live that way, not on my watch. And so you get them determined to go get a college education. In my country, and in yours too, I believe, there was a Bill of Rights, a GI Bill for us, in which those women who had served in the armed forces, whether it was as secretaries or army nurses or whatever, were as entitled to a free education as were the men. And they flooded back into school. And for the first time, we got a huge increase in women with a bachelor's degree. And so we're on our way to making some kind of gender equality, whether we like it or not. Now, what happens is, and here, I beg your indulgence, gentlemen. We get to 1962, 65, in those years right there. We get there, and up until then, college degree or no college degree, the glass ceiling was uneven. There was a glass ceiling. A woman absolutely could not hold a premier position. She could not be head of house. She could not be head of a corporation. It just didn't happen. There was a barrier. And that barrier, which does not exist now thanks to living according to better chemistry, there was a barrier called Mrs. Murphy, which is a euphemism, which is to say that, once a month for about a week, a woman was not intellectually as acute as she was the other 3 weeks. She was socially uncomfortable to some extent. She certainly was emotionally labile. And my one joke is to say that I truly don't understand why it is worse to be emotionally labile, meaning angry as all get out, once a month and get it over with, as opposed to being mad as hell 31 days out of the month the way men do. I don't understand that, but nonetheless, there was that difficulty. In 1962, the birth control pill is finally formulated. In 63, it's released for some clinical trials, and by 64, it's available to everybody. Now, the impact for religion, and please understand Martin Marty, who is perhaps one of the two most respected religionists working in the English language today. He's retired now from the University of Chicago. Martin lists three things in the Perry Emergence that he says are absolutely imperative that we understand the implications if we're going to be church people. One of them is the birth control pill for this reason. When it comes along, it's only about 6 weeks before some woman, and there are records of this also at Michigan, some women begin to say, oh, the big boss is coming in from New York next week, or the big boss is coming in from Minneapolis in 3 weeks, whatever. And Mrs. Murphy is supposed to come that Tuesday, which means she could come on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday. Anyway, I cannot afford to have Mrs. Murphy and the big boss in town if I want to be promoted. And so I will simply borrow two or three or four pills from next month and take them and continue to delay her coming until the big boss is gone. Now, you know, and then I will tell the doctor I dropped them or something, or the dog ate them, and you should see the mess the dog's in, whatever, you know, and get a new prescription. The point is that the birth control, The birth control pill doesn't control birth. I mean, obviously it does control birth, but that wasn't the implicate. That wasn't the impact of what happened. We've always been able to control conception to some greater or lesser extent, says the woman with seven children. But I wanted them. What can I tell you? But what we managed to control was the menses. And now, as you know, many women just don't have a period until they're ready to conceive a child, and they come off the drugs and for a year, and then they conceive, and then they go back on. Nonetheless, what had happened was we're beginning to get the leveling. What has happened now is, and we arrive at where you and I are right now, where in many households the woman earns more money than the man, right? Yeah. Or there are men who stay home and are house husbands. Or they just simply run two careers. And what changes subtly at first, but what changes dramatically before it's over, is that now for the first, Johnny has always gone out before and worked for the home. It was always for the sake of the home. He went out and conquered the world and came back and brought it to the home. Now, he may have misbehaved out here, and that's okay. As long as we were playing the game that it came home and he was doing it for the sake of the home and she regulated it. Now what we've got gradually, but now dramatically in our lives, in our time in 2012, is we've got, she goes out to conquer the world, he goes out to conquer the world, the 2.5 kids go to daycare for 8-10 hours after school, everybody comes home dead tired at the end of the day, right? What I just did is, instead of the home being the center for which the world was engaged, the home now becomes the place that restores you so you can go engage the world. And what happens is that in that home, as it happens, there is a huge change in what's going on. It's hard as all get out to get carry out from Tim Hortons and bring it home and bless it with any kind of meaning, right? You know, it's not a blessable. It's just carry out, for crying out loud. Kids still in Christian homes are invited to pray, but the prayers are heard, which is different from a family altar, right? You can't have a family altar because one parent hears the prayer while the other does the laundry, right? Because we all have to go to work tomorrow, right? Thing after thing. The British, who are way ahead of us in dealing with emergence, are very sure that one of the things we have to go back to is the understanding of tent, synagogue, and temple as the way in which the Abrahamic faiths have always been transmitted and the only way they're ever going to be transmitted. And that what gets lost right here in 62, 63, and 64 is the tent. Because what happens is, and I'm all for all my laughing, I'm all for feminists. I've profited from it too, no doubt. Certainly my daughters have. But for all of our talking about it, what happens when feminism comes along, when we get equality, what happens is that mother is not at home. She's not there. The kids aren't at home. They're in daycare right until 5:30 or 6. So nobody is just casually transmitting the faith. That's what's not happening. One of the things that has to happen in your parish or wherever you are, and I hear it more and more wherever I go, whether it's here or home or in the UK, more and more, that the traditional or inherited church needs to find some way to provide the grandparenting skills that allow for the transmission of the faith at the tent level. Because the young parents, the 40s to 65s, the 20s to 40s who are having children right now, don't have those skills. They were reared after the birth control pill. I'm not being clear, I can tell by your faces. The young people who are parenting right now were reared in what's called a biblically illiterate age, if you will. They never got the tent or the domestic transmission because mama wasn't there to do it. And they are now rearing children into the Christian faith that they don't know how to shape. And one of the imperatives on inherited church, a traditional church, is to find a way to show grandparents how to jump that thing and get to those children so that if it's not mama's tent, it's grandma's tent that prepares them to go to synagogue, that prepares them to go to temple. It's an imperative part. I can't overstress how significant it is or how much I'm now hearing from professional clergy around the English-speaking world about the need to find a way to take those of our congregants who are 60 and over and show them how to do that thing, how to teach the principles of Christianity in such a way that we go back to domestic transmission. So, anyway, we get this, and we're off, and now women are totally, equally, if you will, are equally employed, and financially they're doing very well. And what I jumped in between is a period right here, when from right here to right here, and mainly, if you will, 46 through about 50, 19, 46 through 50. Those are the years when Johnny comes marching home again. Those are the years in which some of the Johnnies who came back aren't all right. We didn't have post-traumatic syndrome, trauma syndrome then. We still had shell-shocked as a definition. But some of our guys came back, your guys, our guys, Brits, whatever, came back absolutely ruined. As one bishop said to me not long ago, they came back card-carrying bastards, and there's no other way to put it, and I suspect he's right. So damaged that they were unfit. In the Presbyterian congregation where I was at that point as a child being reared, there was a wonderful blonde woman. She was little and had the figure to die for, and I was never going to be blonde or little or have the figure to die for, and I think I idealized her because I was 11 at the time. She had two little girls. One was 7 and one was 4. She had been born about 3 months after her father shipped out. When the war was over, he came back. He had been an ideal man, a lovely man. He came back so completely damaged that nobody could even talk to him. He snarled, he cursed, he was everything wrong. But the Bible says, thou shalt not divorce. Our Lord says very little about sexuality, very little. But it's very clear that divorce is wrong, or at least in our canonical scriptures it is. I have a feeling that if there had been a more complete record, he would have allowed for a get. I don't know. But nonetheless, what we've got says, you know, divorce is wrong. This woman, this beautiful woman, stuck with this awful man for about 9 months, until, because the Bible says thou shalt not divorce, until he picked up the younger baby and threw her into the wall and broke the arm straight out like this, saying, it's not my kid, couldn't be my kid, I wasn't here when, you know, 3 months after he leaves, she's born, there's no question it's his kid, trying to kill the kid. At that point, the woman divorces. Now, this is a good Presbyterian church, all right? At that point, she divorces him, and everything is fine until the Sunday after the decree is final. When that decree is final, two of our elders, God-fearing, good human beings, go out and meet her and the two children on the street, and take her up to the balcony so she will not in any way contaminate, as an adulteress, contaminate the nave. The first Sunday that the Eucharist is offered, called the Lord's Supper, by the way, by Presbyterians, and offered as infrequently as possible, lest we be confused with Romans, and offered with Welches, but that's a different issue. Before the plate can be uncovered, those two elders go upstairs and remove her and those two children out and put them on the street, lest our Lord's body be contaminated by the presence of an adulteress. Don't know what New Testament they were reading, but not mine. There was a bachelor there who eventually married her. They had a child of their own. He made a good father to those little girls. And everything was fine for him until the Sunday after the wedding. And he too got taken upstairs. And the first time we had Lord's Supper, he too got taken out to the street. Because that's what the Bible says. And every part of us, everyone in this room, every bit of your body knows that's wrong. It is absolutely, unmistakably wrong to do that. And it's the beginning of what Emergence call Micah 6:8 theology. What does the Lord thy God require of thee? That thy love mercy, act justly, and walk humbly with your God. And they put that as the core message of moral decision. It's Micah 6:8, and it begins right here in that period right after the war when all of those decisions have to be made. Now, if you read your New Testament, the canonical books of the New Testament, you are perfectly aware, as am I, that we follow a man who exercised Micah 6:8, right? I mean, he did, and everything he did. Somehow we lost it with Protestantism, and so it has come back. Now, on the basis of Micah 6:8, the last part of the sociological cascade, the last playing piece, if you will, is the year 1969. 1969 in Stonewall in New York City. is the year in which gay, lesbian, bi, and trans folk gathered together and said, we now will have our place in the sun. We now will function under Micah 6:8, and we wish to be part of the church. We need to be who we are openly and to be so accepted. Now, before we go here, because I'm aware this is a tense spot, and for the Anglicans among us, with Justin Welby having been confirmed as Archbishop, we're going to hit this again. So let me be perfectly open with you, fairness in advertising. I served for 14 years at the altar with a marvelous priest who had been in a gay relationship, a vowed relationship for years, with the most gorgeous man I ever saw. I kid you not. And the deal was, if they ever split up, I get first dibs on Chris, but that's different, you know. You're never too old to hope, you know. Such a waste it was. I used to look at him and think, damn. Anyway, and this is a number of years ago, because he was gay, we were a completely open and affirming, Anglo-emergent, but affirming congregation. And as a result, we were the only place that many Christians could come comfortably to worship. So about 85% of us were gay, lesbian, bi, or trans. And I make this discussion, or the point here, because the gay and lesbian thing we're going to solve, I think we're 90% toward solution now, as a matter of fact. The one we've not solved is the transgendered and the bisexual, but primarily the transgendered. The transgendered are genuinely hated by most gays and lesbians. If you're at the bottom of the heap, it's nice to have somebody that's slightly lower to kick against. And we had in that congregation over the years some 8 or 10 transgendered who, two of whom drove 100 miles to church and 100 miles back twice a week, once on Sunday and once on Wednesday nights, in order to be able to worship with their fellow Christians. And to watch them go through the agony of the surgery and of the chemical adjustment and what the body has to take in order to do that thing is to no real heartbreak. I shall never forget that one Sunday I stood out in the narthex and saying goodbye to a 21-year-old trans who had been with us for 4 years and who said to me, she was presenting as a woman at that time, she said to me, I'm going on the streets again tonight. And I said, why, Katrina? Don't do that. And she said, I have to. I'm out of money, and I can't take any more from the church, and I have nowhere to go. And I said, stupidly, I knew better, but said it, go to work, honey. And she said, look at me. I have a beard and boobs and no money to get rid of one or the other. I have a penis and a vagina. I can't use a washroom, even at McDonald's, if they would give me a job without offending somebody, and I'd be fired within 3 hours of having used the bathroom for the first time. I have nowhere to go. The following Wednesday night, she was beaten to death on the streets by a John who thought he was buying one thing and got another when he got into it. I remember one of our professors of literature, as a matter of fact, who was moving from male to female and who had a terrible time physically. And we all watched her and loved her and respected a genius, a number of published books, as a matter of fact. And when she finally made it through so that she could go, the acid test always for transgendered is, can you change bathrooms? And when she made it to the Sunday that she could come into the ladies' room, we had a little tea party in the ladies' john. And all the guys were standing out in the hall trying to figure out what the heck we were doing. And Sam and I have managed to, my husband is a retired pulmonologist, to remain close friends with an orthopod who has made the shift from male to female and her present partner who was the wife before. All of which is to say that regardless of whom you quote, somewhere between 9 and 13% of North Americans fall somewhere within the spectrum of gay, lesbian, bi, or trans. That's a lot of people to throw away. It's a lot of people to say God made a mistake on. So wherever you come down on the issue, and I'm sure there's division of thought here, I beg you to remember that these are human beings we're talking about, and that this is Micah 6:8. And regardless of what you do about that, as an academic or just at purely intellectual level, I urge you to understand that what that is not about the gay-lesbian issue per se. It really isn't. What it's about is that this is the last playing piece. It's the last puck in a deadly game. And when we do, as I'm sure we're going to, when we ordain, and the Episcopal Church in the U.S., this GC in July, actually introduced to our whole communion some five transgendered rectors who had been under the radar, but with the knowledge of their bishops had been ordained and had been given positions, so that it's wide open in the States. But whatever we do, we need to understand that when this one is played out, there's nothing left, sociologically speaking, there's nothing left to play sola scriptura, scriptura sola with. Is the Bible opposed to homosexuality? You bet your sweet life it is. Is it patriarchal? Of course it is. Does it admit of slavery? Of course it does. Does it contain Micah 6:8? Yes, it does. And what you do with that is up to you. But Emergence are very clear. They're going with Micah 6:8. Absolutely going with Micah 6:8. And so, sociologically, that's what happens. And there are no more pieces to play that game with. And we probably, those of us in this room, will not live to see the end of it, but we're seeing the last gasps of it. And there's no question about that. I want to take the first decade of the last century. And again, I'm taking on sola scriptura, Protestant inerrancy, biblical literacy, whatever you want to call it. And I'll try to shorten it a little bit. 1900 is the year in which a rock star, there weren't many rock stars in 1900 because there wasn't anything to make rocks out of, stars out of, there wasn't enough media to do it. But there were two of importance, Enrico Caruso, if that means in the singer, if that name means anything to you, and Albert Schweitzer on the organ. And they did get enough coverage so that whatever they did got written up. And 1900, Albert Schweitzer is sitting on his porch, his sun porch, in Alsace-Lorraine, when it suddenly dawns on him, and he says to himself, "Dear God, what if the Christ I worship is not the same as the Jesus of history, of Nazareth?" And he answers himself, "Of course he's not. There's 2,000 years, or in that case, 1,900 years, of us monkeying with Jesus to make the Christ I worship." And it scared him to death. And because he could not resolve the difference, and because he realized that indeed we had intellectualized, we had enculturated, we had contextualized, we had taken Jesus and done all these things to make Christ, when he couldn't get back to Jesus, he said to himself, "Since I can never know my Lord, I will at least live as I think he would live." And consequently, he gives up the organ, and he goes to medical school, and he, you know, the rest he goes to Africa before it's over. It's that, in the course of that thing, though, he wrote a book called The Quest of the Historical Jesus, in which he says, can we find who he really was? Now, it is a term, historical Jesus is a term that was not of Schweitzer's invention. It had been coined in the 1700s by a man named Samuel Romarus, a German theologian. But he was, like all theologians, he was talking to other theologians about this problem, and it really never went anywhere until you got a rock star like Schweitzer talking about it. And when you get a Schweitzer asking that question, then it becomes hugely, oh dear God, he's right. Because it didn't take a rocket scientist to know he was absolutely right. We've monkeyed with him for 2,000 years. We've lost him in 2,000 years of doing on him. So who was it? Now, the historical Jesus then becomes a factor through all the rest of the last century, right? In 1902, Louis Klimt, who was at that time editor of the Christian Herald, said, "I can show you who Jesus of Nazareth was. I will print every single word he spoke in red letters, and they'll pop off the page and knock you in the face, and you'll know who he was," which is the beginning of the red letter edition. That's where it comes from. Is an answer to Schweitzer. And so it goes. By 1903, we've got Schofield saying, Robert Schofield saying, "I can cross-reference and show you who he is." And you get the Schofield Bible along with dispensationalist or premillennialism or whatever it is. I never could figure out whether it was pre or post. It never made any sense to me. But it's all a response to this. By 1945, though, you're getting Nag Hammadi, right? And you're getting the discovery of scriptures that we didn't know. We're back now to the bishop saying, nothing wrong with biblical inerrancy if you can tell me what the Bible is, and the inerrant part's bad. Nag Hammadi, we dig up texts that weren't known at Nicaea, that weren't there when we established the canon. What do we do with those? Made worse in 47 by Qumran. And now all of a sudden we've got manuscripts that seem to add or change, and maybe the canon is ready to be looked at. Who knows? And so we're not quite sure what the Bible is all of a sudden, and it matters terribly. And then we get into the 80s and we get to the Jesus Seminar, right? Ever heard of the Jesus Seminar? The Jesus Seminar is 200 deeply credentialed scholars, dead serious scholars. Jack Spong, mean anything to you? Yeah. Marcus Borg, they're all Jesus scholars at the Jesus Seminar. What are they in the business of doing? Trying to decide, as academics, trained, many of them deeply Christian, trying to decide what Jesus did say and what editors inserted or what monks miscopied or what. What is the real scripture here? Trying to discover the canon. And it's a fascinating thing to watch. They circulate, I've said at the Jesus Seminar 3 or 4 times, I don't know, meets in the Flamingo Hotel in Santa Rosa, California, where the flamingos are straight out of the 50s and still sitting there. They're just, you know, gross a maggot out. But anyway, you've got 200 scholars who have passed papers about one verse of scripture for 6 months, hardcore scholarship. Did he say this or did he not say this? And then they come together in the Flamingo Hotel in the ballroom, and they sit in a great thing like this of chairs, 200 of them around like this, and they're balls, ping pong balls in front of them. And the ping pong balls are of 5 colors. And after they have discussed this verse to death, then they begin to pass a basket. If you think he really did say this, you put a red ball into the basket. If you think there's no way in the world he could have said this, you put a black ball in. If you think maybe but not sure, you know, you put a pink one. I don't think so, but not dead sure, you put a gray one. Absolutely don't know, you put a green one. And this is the way in which we vote on Holy Writ. Aren't you happy? Colored ping pong ball. It's a kick to sit there and watch it, may I say. Yeah. What are they doing? They're recognizing the thing that Schweitzer started in 1900, that it's time to look again at the canon, and the walls didn't fall down. Before you get hysterical, if you will remember right after the great transformation or transition, there's a thing called the Mishnah that Judaism has to take up. Yes, of course. It's time, says Emergence, to look at the canon. It's time also to consider whether it's time to open it, perhaps, or to simply create something like the Mishnah. It's time to see what Justin Martyr had to say. It's time to show our people what Origen had to say, what Irenaeus had to say. We may not take back the Shepherd of Hermas, God forbid, and please tell me no, but we will absolutely take some of the others. It's time to look at the Didache. Those of you who remember the Didache will be pleased to know that Emergence Christians now have at least 6 or 8 translations of that circulating and used for part of their worship, rapidly pushing back toward those first 2 or 3 centuries to what the church was before we intellectualized it in the 4th century. And so we have a real thrust, if you will, against the Bible, again, against inerrancy. And then we get to 1905. 1905 is the year in which a smart-ass young Jew, named Albert Einstein, wrote 4 papers. He was a deeply devout man. He did not attend shul or synagogue, but he's left some fascinating commentary about his devotion to God and his sureness. He wrote those 4 papers when he was 26 years old, and they were going to change everything, absolutely. The first one was about light, in which he said, you know, light will go travel either as a wave or as a bundle, depending on the mechanism through which it comes and the barriers between it and its transmission and its dissemination. And it can change back and forth. It can be a bundle in one place and a wave in another. And I will call those bundles quanta, and I will call one of them quantum. Welcome to the world of quantum physics. It's born in 1905 with Einstein. It's going to change everything that we know about the physical world. The second paper was on Brownian motion, which was named for a man named Robert Brown, who couldn't figure out what it was, but who described it. And I used to do this as a kid in not exactly the country, but close to the country where I grew up. Which is to say, and you probably did it as a child too, kids don't do it anymore because they're playing video games, but you take a bucket of water on a perfectly stable surface like this, and you put it down, and you let it get quiet so that it's not making any motion at all. And then you take some dead thing, I always took pollen, some light little thing, and you drop it right on the surface of the water. Now for a minute, the water's going to tremble, right? Then it gets very still, just like it was. And then, as you watch, remember this? Ever watched it? It begins to move. That pollen begins to move, and it ultimately is going to go over here toward the edge, probably. Nobody knew, that's Brownian motion, nobody knew why it did that. And Einstein said, it does it because you're asking the wrong question or you're making the wrong assumption. You're assuming that stuff's dead. There is nothing, said Einstein, there is nothing in creation that's dead, ever. Should scare you straight into church. There is nothing, there is nothing ever in creation that's dead. And then he said, I can show you it's not dead because it's made up of atoms. And atoms are made up of neutrons and electrons and protons and he didn't say quarks, because we weren't there yet. And if you'll give me time, I'll bust it open and show it to you. Welcome to Hiroshima. Welcome to our ability to absolutely destroy the whole earth and to destroy each other. Welcome to a whole new understanding of what it means to be aggressive, of the chance you're taking. Welcome to Syria. Welcome to the Gaza Strip. Welcome to Iran. Welcome to this afternoon's news. There it is. And nothing is ever dead. Then he wrote the third paper, all in one year, in which he said, at the micro level, I can tell you how fast something's going, but not where it is. Or I can tell you where it is, but not how fast it's going. One or the other, because the two are relative to each other, because all things are relative to each other, and we call this special relativity. He hated it. He went to his grave absolutely hating it. He so wanted a spot that was firmly fixed, that was right here, and there is no spot. Everything is relative to everything else. Nothing exists except in relation to something else. It was followed in 1915 by his paper on general relativity, in which he tried to undo that. In 1927, Heisenberg wrote the principle of uncertainty, or the uncertainty principle, following up on this. The important thing is, welcome to all, almost all, of 20th century philosophy. That is to say, what Einstein proved in the physical world is that everything is related to everything else. And when you get that established, you get relativity. And relativity becomes the theme song of philosophy in the last 100 years. Welcome to Foucault. Welcome to Derrida. Welcome to the existentialists. Welcome to Caputo. And if, seriously, ladies and gentlemen, in the clergy especially, if you don't know who those people are, go find out. Emergence clergy, if there be such, or certainly emergence leaders, are very afraid of seminary education. They're afraid of seminary education for a very good reason. Seminaries come with the Reformation, and they are almost all owned by churches. They're owned by denominations for the purpose of seeing that the rightness of doctrine goes right through to the people who are being ministered to by that clergy person. That, what emergence will say, is not an education, that's a programming process. Give me a doctorate, a PhD, and many of them have them. Give me a doctorate in philosophy from a secular university. Give me a doctorate in 20th century philosophy, and I may be able to talk to my people in a reasonable way. One of the interesting things about all of this is the reintroduction of philosophy into serious theological conversation. I'm going to get there again in a minute, just in a minute. The fourth paper is the one that really most impacts us right now. Energy equals mass times the speed of light squared. We all know it, right? EMC squared. We've known it from the get-go. I said earlier that the Reformation gave us Newtonian physics, and it did. It's called macrophysics, in which Newton said, from Aristotle on, we had known, everything in this world is made of stuff, mass. Here it is, right here. And Newton said, if we slice it and dice it enough, into enough small pieces, we will ultimately get to what it is that is creation. We can. It's called reductionist or reductionist science, those of you who have training in that. It's getting it down until we find the fundamental thing that is creation. Well, now, about the 18th century, we found out that there's another thing, that Newton may have been wrong, or at least incomplete, that there is this thing called energy, and it has no mass, and we can't find it or see it, and we don't exactly know what it is, but there it is there. When Einstein comes along, he says, I can show you what energy is, and I can show you that creation is made up of mass and of energy, and that if we put the two together, we will have what creation is about. And so he wrote that energy is equal to mass times the speed of light squared. And he was right. But he was wrong in thinking that if you just put those two things together, you had it. Because by 1940 and 45, we were getting men like Alan Turing, if that means anything to you, or Claude Shannon, or Norman Wimmer, and if they don't, you need to go look them up too. They are men who are beginning to say, there is mass. That's right. Creation is mass. Also, however, there is indeed energy, but there's one other thing. And when they say it, they are working on the basis of something that began way back when Charles Darwin, when Charlie was doing his kick. When Charles Darwin produced The Origin of the Species in 1859, not almost every scientist working agreed with him. There wasn't any question that he was right on. But there were some scientists, active scientists, who said, but it doesn't explain everything. The most articulate, if you will, of them was a man named Lewes, L-E-W-E-S. He's not the only one. He just wrote 20 books that makes him so articulate you can't bear him. H.G.W. Lewes, if you want to look him up. Lewes said, we have known from the time of Aristotle that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, which is what Darwin is really saying. But occasionally, there is a time in which the whole is not only greater than the sum of its parts, it's greater than anybody could have predicted from a careful analysis of the component parts. It makes no sense. And so Lewes postulated that somewhere, not top down, because they didn't believe in that either, but at some point, there is a thing that comes in from somewhere laterally, right here near the top, or on the side, if you will, of the new thing, of the new whole, and diffuses through all of it. And he said, for instance, human consciousness cannot, or intelligence, he called it, cannot be explained by Darwinianism. Now, those of you who have creationist friends are very aware that this is one of their arguments, that you cannot explain human consciousness with the origin of the species. You can't. Lewes was the first to say, with his friends, the first to say, that won't happen. Something comes in right here, and we don't know what it is, but what it causes is an emergence of a new thing. There's our word. Emergence of a new thing that is greater than you would ever have been able to see or predict or construct from its component parts. And they did all kinds of things with it. And before the turn of the century, they're calling it emergence theory. For what it's worth, the Great Emergence was named by biologists and chemists out of the lab. It was not named because it looks like something is emerging, which is what's wrong with the name, which is why I really wish we could call it the Great Convergence and get over emergence. Emergence was named in labs because it reflects this thing of something coming in and creating a whole greater than its parts. Now, by the turn of the century, people like, well, Sigmund Freud is playing with it to some extent, but William James is playing with it, and certain biologists are playing with it, and they begin to understand, you know, incidental to that, that for instance, and there's a wonderful book called The Starfish and the Spider, which is fun to read. For instance, if you take a spider and do this to it, you're going to rip his leg off, and he's going to bite you and then die. If you take a starfish and do this to it, he could care less, he's going to grow a new leg, right? And the leg's going to grow a new starfish. Why? Because this one is emergence. This is an example of emergence organization. This is basically communal. Nobody is in charge. When you watch a flock of birds go by, and one comes from around the back and takes over and starts leading, and then in 20 minutes another one comes over and starts leading, and then it's emergence theory. Nobody's in charge. E.O. Wilson, one of the more prominent entomologists working in the English language right now, has a wonderful novel called The Trailhead Queen is Dead. And he preceded into The New Yorker in January of 11, as a matter of fact, if you want to go read it, in the fiction section. It's a fictional presentation of emergence theory in which he says, you know, anthills and beehives are not the same. We have for years, until emergence theory came along, we thought they were the same, right? And we give them both queens. Now, I live in the country, and beehives do have queens, and they absolutely do their trick. And we had five hives, and the last thing you need is the sixth queen, because it's hell on wheels till you get rid of one of them, because they're arbitrary and just as fit as they can be, you know, and they're going to run their place. We thought ants had the same sort of structure, though we couldn't catch them at it. Well, says E.O. Wilson, and he's having a good time with it, says Wilson, of course not. An anthill works by emergence theory. That is to say, there is a queen. She's only good for one thing. She's the original dumb blonde. She takes one nuptial flight, and a drone gets on board, and they fly, and they fly, and they fly, until he drops off dead, which is not a bad way to go. But anyway, he drops. And she drops to the ground. And the only thing she has to do in her whole life is right now, in the next 48 hours, she's going to lay 4 to 6 larvae, inseminated egg larvae. And they're on the surface of the ground, and she's got to lick them constantly for 36 to 48 hours, because that's the area where the bacteria lives, is on the surface of the ground. She's got to keep the bacteria off of them so they can hatch. If indeed she is successful, the 4 to 6 larvae, once they hatch, will begin to scratch around like this and make their way, and they will take the layer of bacteria-laden topsoil off, and she'll drop down another level. And this can go on level after level after level for as much as 22 years. 22 years off of one shot. Now, there's a man, ladies, but that's not the point. You know, she's down there doing this, and we get this huge thing. But you know what? They're not there to build this thing. They're just doing their trick. Nobody's in charge. They work by pheromones. They talk to each other by odor. There's no head. And when the queen dies and there are no more babies coming along and the thing isn't building any higher, they either die or they go off somewhere else. That hill doesn't mean anything. Totally nimble, totally transient, totally non-real estate. Characteristics of emergence, characteristics of emergence Christianity. Don't give me a cathedral, don't want the thing. Don't give me real estate, no. Give me nimbleness. Allow me to be able to move quickly and nimbly. Perfect example of emergence. And so what we get is emergence theory, and we get people beginning to play with it. And they continue to play right up until you get into the 40s and you hit Alan Turing. Alan Turing is the father of the proto-computer. He is the first to say, oh, what the universe is composed of is mass and energy and information. All of creation can be reduced to an expression of zero and one. Everything can be reduced to an explanation or a presentation of zero, one, zero, one, zero, one, zero, one. He's followed by Claude Shannon. He's followed by Norman Light, and we're off on information theory. Which is to say, we now know, and it's only been in about the last 30 years that we have known, that creation is composed of mass and of energy and of information. One of the most remarkable things about Emergence Church or the Emergence Christian experience, or living in our times, whether we live as inherited or traditional, doesn't matter, or fresh and fresh, doesn't matter, is the rapprochement for the first time ever between theology and philosophy and science, in which they are coming together to say, oh, this is what we're made of. And the message, not because I'm Christian or you're Christian, but because it's being spoken by philosophers of no particular religious affiliation and by hardcore physicists as they meet together. The word is, you Christians, you Abrahamites, you Judeo-Christians, you've had it right to start with. In arche hologos, hologos hateos enim, in the beginning was the word. And so it is that Emergence embraces science and philosophy as well as theology, because it's come to be in a time and a framework where it is clear that indeed the third and probably final component of creation is indeed information, hologos. And we have known it all along. And because we were literalists or inerrants and not actualists, fail to realize the implication. We fail to realize the magnitude of the gift and the thing to be honored in all of our praise and in all of our worship.